From coast to coast, live via satellite, it's time to praise the Lord. Comes to major Christian events in America and across the world, covering over 500 million souls with the good news of new life in Jesus Christ. Now, from Tacoma, Washington, we invite you to be a part of the world's largest prayer and praise gathering. On Praise the Lord from the Love Boat, Gavin and Patty McLeod. God Smuggler, Brother Andrew. President Samaritan First, Franklin Graham. Senator Ellen Craswell of Washington. Honorable Mayor Douglas Sutherland of Tacoma. And ministering music, songwriter and recording artist Jeff Finward. Now your hosts, president and founder of the Trinity Broadcasting Network, Paul and Jay.
Welcome to the good ship Trinity.
Trinity Love Boat.
The Trinity Love Boat is ready to be christened tonight. And in fact, we goofed up a little bit in the break, so I think the captain of the ship is right behind me, and before we go any further with the program tonight, and before we hit the bank over there, let's have the captain give us a little word of greeting.
Hi, I'm Captain Gavin McLeod. Welcome to TBN's Love Boat!
Thank you, Captain. I will do my best to steer a straight course. And I just would kind of like to ask you all here in the great Seattle-Tacoma area, how do you like your new television studio and your beautiful new ship's quarters and set? I think Jan did a wonderful job getting everything put together, and we are ready for our maiden voyage.
Yes, we are. And we're fishing for men on our boat.
I see.
Fishing for men. We want everyone to know that Jesus loves them. And I think it's just mighty pretty.
I do.
I think we've just outdone ourselves here in Seattle.
First Mate Jan is here tonight, and we'll have a lot of good singing and sharing and testifying. In fact, I'll tell you what I'd like all of you to come. Franklin Graham is here tonight. Brother Andrew, God Smuggler, is here. Would you all just come and join me on either side? We also have the honor of having his honor, the mayor of Tacoma, Mr. Douglas Sutherland, with us tonight, and also one of your state senators here from the Washington area, Senator Ellen Craswell. And Jeff Benward is here to sing, and of course you've already met Gavin and Patty McLeod, and we'll have them share a little bit right now. There's another very important purpose for this meeting tonight, and that is this is the very first live Praise the Lord program nationally that we have originated from your beautiful new studio here in Seattle, Tacoma. And we want to take this opportunity to dedicate it completely unto the Lord. A few weeks ago, months ago I guess now, kind of an informal gathering of some of our prayer partners while the walls were still going up, we joined hands and we prayed and consecrated this ground unto the Lord. But now this house of the Lord is finished, and we're excited to be here tonight, and we're going to give it all back to Him in praise and thanksgiving and honor that this great love boat will indeed become the fisher of men that Jan mentioned just a moment ago.
You know, just think of the times that ships and boats are talked about in the Bible. Remember, the very first boat was built by God, the ark. That's Brother Andrew's thought. And yes, behind the scenes, God gave the dimensions for the very first boat. And it was a love boat.
Literally.
Literally a love boat. But it was just, but just think of the times that ships were mentioned. And it was really their only means of transportation. Paul went to Rome in a boat, and Jonah tried not to go to Nineveh in a boat. We throw all false prophets over in Puget Sound. If you hear splashes, you'll know it's guests that were phonies.
Oh, dear. We hope we don't have any of them tonight. The Apostle Paul was shipwrecked on his boat, so we trust that that will not be our fate tonight.
All right.
I think before we go further, it would be a very high honor. Would you escort His Honor Douglas Sutherland, Mayor of Tacoma, over here? And I think we ought to give His Honor a great praise the Lord welcome tonight and have him give us a brief word of greeting. Thank you very much.
That's really very kind of you, and we're delighted to have you here in our area. Actually, you're halfway between Seattle and Tacoma.
Yes.
And so, in between, welcome.
All right.
We're delighted to have you here, and certainly we wish you the very best. Success is one of the things that you need, and obviously you'll work hard for it. Thank you for coming to our part of the world, and the very best to you both.
Thank you, sir.
As well as your ship.
Yeah, thank you. If you'll remain with us for a moment, Your Honor, we will have our dedicatory prayer. While the studio is located, as you say, somewhere between Seattle and Tacoma, that was a political move on our part, sir, to try and keep peace between these two great families up here, and I'm sure that's a principle you will understand. We are, however, licensed by the Federal Communications to the city of Tacoma, so we want to always make it clear that we are here to serve. And if you, sir, have areas of public concern that need to be addressed and spoken to, by all means, please contact us. And we understand that obligation and take it very seriously. Jan, honey, would you bring our other honored guest here tonight, Senator Ellen Craswell, representing the 23rd District of Kipsat County. Did I say it right?
Kitsap
County. Actually, the transmitter for Channel 20 is across the sound over on a beautiful mountain called Gold Mountain, and I understand that's very close to your district that you represent, Senator Craswell. She served 4 years as a state representative during 76 to 80, accepted Christ in 1980, served 7 years, and is currently serving in the Washington State Senate. She's a member of Shorecrest Baptist Church, a very fine church that has a ministry of encouraging Christians to get involved in politics, of all things. Let's tell Senator Ellen Craswell, welcome to Praise the Lord tonight. God bless you.
How are you tonight? Give us a little word of greeting, and then I'll ask you a couple of questions.
Thank you. I, too, would like to welcome you to the state of Washington, and I'm just delighted that you're here and really looking forward to your program.
Thank you. I understand that, in a sense, as an outgrowth of the great Washington for Jesus convocation in 1980, the word and the witness of Christ reached you. There's a little story there. Could you share it briefly with us?
Well, I didn't know this until just recently. I discovered that I accepted Christ just a few days after the Washington for Jesus rally, and I know that there were thousands of people from this state in Washington, D.C., praying for all their elected officials. So I believe that I was prayed into the kingdom through those faithful people.
Can you tell us just how that happened?
Well, it really happened through my husband. He was forced to wait for me throughout many, many meetings because I was the one involved in politics, and he would drive me places and have to wait, and he got thrown together with the wife of a friend of mine who was also in the legislature, and she kept witnessing to him, and pretty soon he accepted the Lord, and just about 6 weeks later, I kind of slipped right in behind him, and my life has never been the same since, and I praise God for that.
Oh, that's beautiful. Okay. If you are a part of a church that encourages Christians to get involved in politics, how does that square with, you know, the hue and cry we hear, separation of church and state? Is that not kind of an impossibility, as it were?
Well, one of the things that really troubled me, I spent 4 years in the legislature not as a Christian, doing what was right in my own eyes and leaning on my own understanding, because I didn't know there was anything else upon which to base my legislative decisions. And it wasn't until after I accepted Christ that I began to discover that Christianity was meant to have a very big part in politics or government, if you will, and it wasn't because people were believing what I believe is Satan's lie, that politics and religion shouldn't mix. So that became a tremendous burden on me. I guess the first thing I discovered was that Christ had a plan for my life, and when I was in it, things went fine, and every time I step out of it, nothing works. But it wasn't too long after that I discovered the same is true for government. God has a plan for government, and when government is in that plan, government is going to work properly the way God intended it to, and it's going to be a blessing to the people. But when government steps out of that plan, nothing works, and when we as legislators try to make government do something that God never intended it to do, it just plain isn't going to work. And it doesn't matter how many millions of dollars we put into programs, if it isn't part of God's plan, it isn't going to work, and it's going to end up causing problems.
Do I have an amen out there? Well said, Senator Caldwell. We do say amen to that. All right. How should Christians get involved in politics then?
Well, there's so many things that the Bible tells us to do. For one thing, it says that when the righteous are in authority, the people rejoice. And if the Christians are going to believe Satan's lie that politics and religion doesn't mix, we're never going to get the righteous in authority. So they need to vote, and they need to encourage God-fearing people to be in office. You know, it goes even a step further than that. I believe God gives us four qualifications for the kinds of people that should be in positions of authority. Do you recall when Jethro told Moses he needed some help and to put some people in positions of authority? He said in Exodus 18:21 that they ought to be men who are able, God-fearing, men of truth, and hating covetousness. And I think that Christians need to encourage, I think they need to pray and ask for God's leading in who should run for office, and then encourage those kinds of people and then help them get elected.
By registering and voting.
Right, and offering to help on campaigns. I think when God raises up his people to run for office, he doesn't expect them to do it all by themselves.
That's what Jan and I have always encouraged people to do, regardless of political affiliation. We've teased a little bit and said we don't really care if you're Dixiecrat, Democrat, Republican, whatever, but judge your candidates, as this senator has admonished us, on their stand on the moral issues that really confront us today. And I won't put the cameras on you tonight, but just for my information and perhaps for the Honorable Mayor and your state senator's edification, if nothing else, you can get a picture of this. We won't give your name, but how many of you in this room are registered to vote? Let me just see your hands. Oh, ho, ho. All right. How many are not registered to vote? I don't think he's old enough to vote anyway, but anyhow. We've got a room full of voters here tonight, folks, and it looks like you folks up in the Washington area are serious about this. Now, I'll ask you one more little question. How many of you did vote, let's say, in the last congressional elections just a little over a year ago? You did vote, all right? How many were registered but did not vote for whatever reason? I'm not going to scold you or anything, but okay. We all have situations from one time or another. We are moving, Senator Craswell, into an election year now next year. Are there, I'm sure there must be registration deadlines in the state of Washington here that people might ought to be aware of.
In this state, you have to be registered to vote 30 days before the election, so it's not a difficult thing to do.
And people can register many different places, can they not?
Public schools, libraries, usually fire stations, courthouses, city halls, lots of places.
Did His Honor the Mayor have a thought on registering to vote?
I just wanted to let you know that elections are every year, not just during congressional municipal elections are in the first Tuesday of November, immediately coming up upon us. And those are probably even far more important, or leastwise as important, as congressional and national elections. And all too often, people tend to forget those which affect them most closely.
Indeed. All right. Well, we're certainly glad to be here in the state of Washington, and we're so thankful that the Lord has given us this strong voice, which we call KTBW, Channel 20, to hold up the hands of our elected representatives. The scriptures are very clear. We are to obey those who have the rule and the authority over us, the scripture says. And we are to provide also those things honest in the sight of all men. So we just want these representatives of two different aspects of government here in Washington to know that we are praying for you. We will be lifting your hands. And if there's ever anything we can do to be of assistance to you, by all means, let us know. Will you stay with us for a word of prayer? Gavin and Patty McLeod, come on over here. Let's tell the captain we're glad he's here tonight. Hello, Patty.
Hi, Paul. Wonderful, thank you.
You you did a fine job of welcoming us with the captain's bell. And
well, it's such a beautiful port to pull into, you know, and you know, the Lord knows we're going to be here for a long time, and that's very, very important. The set is just beautiful. It brings back a lot of the old memories that of our traveling days on the Love Boat, the make-believe Love Boat. This is the real one.
The real Love Boat. God's love. Yes, sir. You know, we thought it would be great to have all of us join around the steering wheel here, which I guess is kind of where the captain hangs out most of the time, and just have you lead us in a word of prayer as we dedicate not only this complete studio that is now finished, filled with TV cameras and lights, and now Jan has designed a beautiful new set, and we just couldn't think of anybody more appropriate than yourself to be here tonight for this wonderful occasion.
Thank you so much. All right. Oh, Father, this is just an awesome moment for Patty and I to be invited here on this auspicious evening and to share with all of the wonderful family here, of your family, to ask you to guide this new station, this Love Boat.
Amen.
Guide it every day, morning, noon, and night, so that it heals people, so that truly it adds up to what your love means. The real love of our life experience. Yes. You know, people come, people go. We put faith in other human beings. Lord, they leave us. They fall. They're merely human. But you are always there. So we hope that this ship of yours, we dedicate this to you, Lord, that this ship will always be floating, be in a straight direction, getting your word of love and care and health to everyone that hears. We praise you, God. We give you the glory for all of us being here together, for the health of everyone that's listening to us, to that maybe they can hear by watching this show tonight, or this presentation tonight, or this experience tonight, and every single day, they may learn that through trial and error, you are truly the only way, the only light, the only sustenance for their life that is. We love you, Lord. We pledge our obedience to you, and we thank you for the miracles you're doing not only in our life, but in the lives of everyone here within my voice. We lift up this wonderful, true Love Boat in the Seattle-Tacoma area, and fittingly in the middle of these two great cities, and we dedicate it in your name, in the name of Jesus of Nazareth. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. Well, I guess we are underway, are we not? Would you come down for a moment, Jan? Y'all just stay right here for a moment. Jeff Benward's going to bless us in song, but I was fascinated by this piece of gear. I see that, and this obviously is from a real ship, because we have a stern and we have a head. And Brother Andrew said a while ago, we never want to go backwards. We always want to go forward. So We're on standby right now. This is Dead Slow. I don't like that name either. I don't like slow either. Half I don't like, but full speed ahead. The Love Boat is underway, all right? Oh, praise God. Gavin and Patty will not only be with us tonight, but tomorrow night sharing testimony. And I know you'll all want to be here or at least be tuned in. Jeff Benward is here from Houston. Is Channel 14 doing well and on the air?
Yes, sir. All we right. Even bought a brand new television for our bedroom, my wife and I.
Did you
with
really?
A remote control just to watch Channel 14.
Just to get 14.
And I'm sure Candy's watching.
Yes, yes.
Hi, baby.
What a joy to have Jeff Benward with us tonight. And so to all of our Houston folks, you're represented tonight, and we're going to sing a great song of praise with him as he leads our ship on out into deeper waters. The song says, Crown Him. Let's welcome Jeff Benward.
Let the heavens proclaim His glory. Let the earth sing His praise. Let the wind tell the story of His matchless ways. Almighty Father, Creator King, all of creation sings. Crown Him with glory, crown Him with honor, crown Him the display His majesty. Let the ocean show His boundless love. Let the trees paint the tapestry as He colors the earth from heaven above. Almighty Father,
McLeod, would you tell the chef I'll have shrimps and oysters on the half shell and just anything to wash it down with. Okay?
Okay, Patty, you're on.
I thought maybe we would have the captain and his good lady stay with us because not only, as I said, are they here tonight, but tomorrow night as well. And Gavin, could you give us a little idea of some of the things you might like to share tomorrow night?
Yeah, we would like to share some of the miracles the Lord has done, not only in our lives, but in some of our friends' lives since we saw you last. And the most recent thing was a miraculous healing that only he could do with a very dear friend of ours in Palm Springs. We want to share that with you at great length. One of the greatest miracles in our lives right now.
Mackenzie Steele Zalen, our first grandson.
Whoa! And if you Jan all... has competition.
Oh, now she has competition, but now I understand what Jan has been talking about. But tomorrow night we just happen to have a few dozen snapshots.
I see.
And maybe the cameraman can get a little close-up of our baby.
What's that gorgeous name again?
Mackenzie, and they call him Mac after Gavin.
How
but
cute.
I call him Biggs. And I don't know what he's going to call me, because he's only 2 months old.
Oh, let him call you Grandma.
Okay.
That's a very
well, the secret is,
Grandma.
You see, they call him Little Mac, and I'm Big Mac. We hang out together. You know,
I see.
Whenever he needs to have a diaper fixed, Big Mac will take care of him. And then we have something else that I think will illustrate to the people. We were in a situation recently, and Patty said, I'm going to pray to God that he helps us. I said, there is no way. He can do this. No way he can do this. I was just clamped in there with the fact that we were caught in a situation that there was no way of getting out of. And I don't know, maybe a lot of people have been like that at home or out there.
Yes, sir.
And it was 2 days later, mm-hmm. was it, honey? Mm-hmm. The Lord changed every single thing that I was thinking. And it just, well, I'll tell you more about it tomorrow. We will tell you more about it tomorrow. And just to illustrate the fact that you have to have faith. You have to know that he's going to do it in his time when he wants to do it. And she just knew that he was going to do it. And I said, there is no, I don't know how. It doesn't make any difference what I think or what we think. It's what he thinks.
Amen.
And the way he moves in miraculous ways.
And it was strange because Gavin has such faith. And he's such a man of God now, but he could not, you know, he couldn't get a hold of it.
I just couldn't see how he was going to do this.
But once, and of course, it's almost like, well, it couldn't happen till we really got in agreement about it. Mm-hmm. And one day, he sort of, it all clicked into his head, and he said, I know now that God can do it, and I'll tell you, within, what, a week or so.
I also said, I don't know how he's going to do it.
Yeah.
I still don't know, but he's going to do it.
And it's a financial thing. It has to do with creating a sum of money.
I was going to ask.
Coming through.
It could never have happened. Yeah.
Yeah, a financial situation.
Okay.
It's
out
very
of the
exciting.
Blue.
Very exciting.
Complete, but not out of his blue.
All right.
But, you know, sometimes, too, though, God has been so good to us, but I think, you know, Patty, you have to love the Lord and praise the Lord. Not for what he does for us alone. He does, but just because he's God and because he's always there looking over us with his hand always on us.
And for the marriages that might be hurting as well, can we touch maybe a little on that
tomorrow? Oh, yeah, we can touch a lot on that tomorrow.
Yeah,
we'd love to touch on that.
How long were you separated?
We were divorced for 3 years.
And you see, it was really a broken thing. Gavin didn't want it restored. He didn't want to see me. So many people say, but you don't understand, you know, this is happening, that's happening. There was really nothing more broken. It doesn't look to people now. It almost seems like it was so easy. Well, it was easy once God got a hold of it. Mm-hmm. But our reconciliation wasn't easy. Our forgiveness of each other wasn't easy. But
the obedience was there. And from that obedience came the miracle. And the miracle is that we have a relationship now that I never thought I could ever have with another living human being. Mm. A commitment that I never thought I could ever have. And it's all because of God and committing to God first and having him see because of that and the dedication and the other communication. You know, we had the big earthquake the other day?
Yeah.
Sure.
Well, I had just come down from Omaha Boys Town, and I was doing this picture for Disney. It's on November 29th. It's a very nice, wonderful family picture.
There'll be more plugs tomorrow night.
But anyway, so I had 4 hours sleep and then drove up to Canyon Country to work in the morning. So I arrived at location about 8:15 in the morning. And this man pulled up. I said, well, how was your drive up here? I said, oh, it was beautiful. I said, I've got to come up here again sometime. He said, well, any other cars? All right. I said, oh, cars would just stop for traffic, you know. I guess it's like that all the time. He said, well, I'm glad you made it. I said, I'm glad I made it, too. He says, you know, we had a big disaster. I said, what disaster? He said, there was an earthquake. I said, come on, man, there was an earthquake. He says, yeah, there was an earthquake. I thought he was pulling my leg. And then one of the little actresses came over and said, oh, I was in my first earthquake. I'm from New York City. I had my first earthquake. And I said, I didn't feel a thing, because when I was going up to work, as I always do when I go to work in the morning, I was talking to the Lord and praying in tongues. So I'm telling you, if you want to be protected, just continue to do that. I didn't know anything happened. I'm probably the only person in the whole area.
Jan and I had the good sense to be in Denver, Colorado while it all happened. Yes, yes.
But anyway, so we have so much to share tomorrow, and we are looking forward to that with great love and anticipation.
Well, we're glad that Gavin and Patty could come and be our honorary captains of the Trinity Love Boat tonight. Amen.
Thank you. So
bless you. I'll be back to see you after a while. If my shrimp comes, call me, okay? This is a beautiful set, and I already feel at home on it. The big, another big captain steering wheel here, and nice little count. You do a nice job.
Thank you.
Making these sets.
I don't sing or preach or shout. I will shout sometimes.
Oh, you shout.
But I do sets.
She preaches to me at home quite a lot.
True.
Yes. I want you to meet another wonderful brother. You seem so far away somehow. Can we get a little closer here? I don't think he really needs an introduction, but maybe up in this area he does. Brother Andrew. I will not try to pronounce his last name. It's one of those wonderful Dutch names.
Just Van der Bijl.
Say again.
Just Van der Bijl.
Van der Bijl.
Yeah.
Van
Simple.
Der Bijl. Well, that's not
that's
so.
That's all.
Yes, that kind of sounds like wonderful. Brother Wonderful is here tonight. Yes. He is the founder and president of Open Doors, an international ministry directed toward Christian living under governments that do not allow freedom of worship and witness as we know it and are so blessed by it here in the United States. Brother Andrew has been smuggling Bibles into communist countries since 1955. He is the author of 4 books, and of course I suppose we will always remember him best for his fascinating life story entitled God's Smuggler. From originally Holland, now he calls Santa Ana home.
No, still Holland.
Oh, still Holland?
Sure, I just came
I
from Holland
2 days ago. Had adopted
I
us.
Have an office in Santa Ana.
I see. Mm. We can't claim you totally then.
No,
anyhow,
not yet.
From the wonderful country of Holland, let's tell Brother Andrew. Welcome tonight. Howdy.
Thank you.
How are you?
Great.
I know we've got lots of interesting things to share. He's just come back from Saudi Arabia, by the way, and some interesting things are happening over there. But I always love to have you take just a minute, Brother Andrew, and tell us, okay, where did that first idea come from to literally walk up to a border of a communist country with contraband, Bibles that aren't allowed, and ask permission to go into that country. And I want you to relive that first little episode when you did it for the very first time.
Can we go slow first?
Yeah.
Enough time.
Okay. Yeah. You okay. Can, not dead slow, just slow.
Just slow, yeah. Okay. Yeah. Otherwise, we run out of time. It's a fascinating thing. Even when I think back, I think it's terrific because who was I that in the Missionary Training College I picked up a magazine that told me about the youth movement of 97 million young people? Never heard of anything like that. I was a church worker, our youth groups, you know, struggling to get them together. 97 million in one movement, in one organization, I'd never heard of it. We were totally ignorant of communism at that time in 55. And they were going to have big festivals, and I was just gripped. I knew I had to do something. I also knew I couldn't tell anybody. They would discourage me. And I just ordered lots of scriptures in all the East European and Russian languages. I just went across the border to meet those young people who were carrying their red banners and chanting, "We are poor and we are ragged, but we are going to conquer the world and we are going to change the world." Mm. And I saw them. I saw hundreds of thousands. In the end, I saw millions of them because I saw all those huge parades in Cuba, in Havana, in Moscow, in Bucharest, in Nanking, in Peking, in all those cities. And I saw how determined they were to change the world. And I knew there was only one thing that I could give, and that was the Word of God and the love of Jesus. So I was pressing this little book to my heart, and God spoke that every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And then I had my mandate. I was going to go there and give them the Word so that they would have an opportunity to make a choice. Mm-hmm. Now, this is the problem when they isolate a country, whether it be communistic or Islamic, they do not have access to the word, then they have no choice.
True.
I was in the SWAPO headquarters in Angola, and all I saw were Lenin statues on the desks. I said, that's not fair. I brought some Gideon Bibles. I said, you must put a Gideon Bible next to Lenin, let people have a choice.
Amen.
They said, yes, and so I put it right there next to Lenin.
And they let you?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. They always do, it seems. But when they have a choice, they will choose Jesus. If they can make a sensible choice, and that's why we must present those people, especially in the so-called closed, but they're not closed, they're restricted countries. Do you realize, Paul, that at this moment 66% of the world population lives in restricted countries?
66%.
And it is estimated that in the year 2000, 83% of the entire world population will live in restricted countries.
Are we losing them?
Yes, we are losing. We're losing the battle for the minds of people. I got some bad news. I love to tell only the good news. There's good news too. But there is bad news. We better face up to reality, otherwise we never prepare for battle. That's what the Apostle Paul said. He said, if the trumpet makes an unclear sound, who will prepare for battle? Mm-hmm. I want to tell things as they are, call people to repentance in our own so-called Christian nations, and then call people to dedicate themselves to the Lord and go out, and don't look at borders that look dangerous. Of course they are dangerous, but it's far more dangerous to stay at home in disobedience and see your kids go on drugs. And see a permissive society develop because we have no principles, we show no backbone, mm-hmm. we have no muscles, we have no convictions, and we just play church, we play Christianity. This is bad, this is a warfare, we've got to do something about it. Mm-hmm. Well, that got me off, and boy, that's over 32 years ago, and I'm still there.
Wow.
Whoa. We salute you.
So, okay. The mandate, the dream, the desire finally had to take form. What did you do? Did you just get a couple of suitcases full of Bibles and go to the border and say, here I am?
Yeah.
How did that happen?
Well, I first boarded the train on the first trip. And incidentally, on that very first trip, and I was a very young missionary, just came out of college, they threatened to kill me by throwing me off the moving train because they discovered there was somebody sneaking in with another message. And I pretended to be asleep, so they eventually let me. And then that's how I got in. And I had a fascinating time. On my first trip, I met Tommy Hicks. He just came out of Russia, told me terrific stories. I met young people. I met soldiers in the Red Army, to whom I all gave a John's Gospel. They were delighted the first time they had the Word of God. Nobody ever tried to arrest me once I got inside. Mm-hmm. And I've seen an openness as I have never seen in the so-called free countries.
So that first trip, you weren't even challenged? They didn't search your luggage? They just let you through?
Yeah, they let me through.
How many Bibles were you carrying?
I had only one suitcase at that time, mm-hmm. which grew into two suitcases, which grew into a station wagon, which grew into a delivery van, which grew into a recreational vehicle. Now, I must stop here. Slow. I shouldn't reveal my trade secrets. We take loads and loads in the scriptures.
Yes, yes.
How many do you estimate you've taken all together?
I talk about millions of Bibles now.
Really?
In one night, we even delivered 1 million complete
in
Bibles
China?
To China.
Yes.
Are you free to talk about that now?
About China, I can talk now.
One of our employees was on the boat.
Terrific.
Terry Hickey.
Yeah,
Terry.
Yeah.
That's right.
They say that was the greatest thing that any single mission had ever accomplished to do that.
A million?
Sure. You know, just stop and think about this a minute, everybody. What would you do first?
To get the gospel.
If you were given the assignment of getting 1 million Bibles into communist China, what would you do first tonight before you go to... Jen said I would faint.
I think I was praying fast.
But that, of course, took, I'm sure, months and months of preparation.
Very
planning.
Careful planning. Actually, we built a very large barge just for this occasion that could submerge.
We built it.
Yeah, we built it. And
only
used it once, and then we demolished it. But one side could go out, so and then the whole ship would sink, and all the Bibles were packed in large watertight parcels. They floated. We had a number of little speedboats on board, and they zoomed up to the beach, and there were 20,000 Chinese believers on the beach waiting for our Bibles. We had arranged that. But because they had asked for it, you see, it was not our idea, it was their idea.
So they grabbed him and ran.
They ran, and then we got back in the speedboats. In the meantime, the boat was pumped up again, you know, pumped the water out. The boat came up, and we had a big tugboat, and we sailed back to Hong Kong.
And no serious incidents?
Not really. Only after, actually, this year, they begin to arrest Christian Chinese who work with us on Project Pearl. Because they're still furious, they're still writing. Even last year, I saw an article in the Chinese Communist newspaper, even naming me and blaming me for the million Bibles that got in such an illegal, terrible way. It was a complete invasion in enemy territory.
Yes.
Very effective, though. We loved it.
Are you persona non grata in China today because of that?
Well, yeah, I better don't show my face.
But better to obey God than man, right?
Absolutely. Well, I have enough people doing it now, so why should I go? There are other areas where my people don't go, and there I go. I still pioneer.
You gave me a statistic today about Christians in China, and it just shocked me.
Oh, yeah.
How many?
There are at least 50 million Christians now in China.
Yeah. That is unbelievable.
That's 5% of the total population. That's huge.
Because for 30 years, they would be shot if they mentioned the name of Jesus.
But now, of course, this creates a tremendous problem, because how do they get enough Bibles? And I was together with the Bible Society recently, and they said, Brother Andrew, between us, that meant Open Doors and the Bible Societies, we can never meet that need, because there's a proven need for 18 million Bibles right now in China. They said, how can we do it? Let's work together. Let's do something.
Well, with a million, that's only one Bible per 50 believers.
Well, exactly.
Plus the unbelievers
that
need the
word.
It's still
nothing. We still must have a lot more faith and dedication and determination to get the Word of God in, so that we win the battle for the minds of the Chinese. They're now in a vacuum. Nobody believes in communism anymore, not in China, nor in Russia, nor wherever. It's dead as an ideology.
Yes.
Now,
but
really,
now there's a
really,
vacuum.
Really, really, wait. You passed over that pretty fast.
Slower.
Stop it. Stop.
Stop.
Up to stop.
Dead slow.
Dead slow.
Okay. What? Nobody believes in communism?
No, no.
Anymore?
No.
Not really in their
not
hearts.
Not as an ideology. No, they're either capitalistic in their heart, as they always were. Communism has failed. I mean, that's why there's a new direction, the glasnost, in Russia under Gorbachev, Gorby for short, you know, almost. And because they got to come up with new ideas, otherwise they lose the entire population.
So now's the time to go in with the gospel as never
you
before.
You said it, Jan. This is the time.
Whew.
I'm confused over something. You're telling me that in one sense, more and more people are coming under
communist rule,
but yet you're telling me that as an ideology, communism is dying.
They still reign with power. They have the gun. And power comes out of the barrel of the gun, as Mao said.
Mm-hmm. They have to put up fences to keep them in.
That's why we have an iron curtain, and that is still effective. I tell you, since Glasnost, and this will surprise you, the border crossings are harder than ever. And since Glasnost, the price on the black market for Bibles has gone up fourfold. Mm. You now pay 3 months' salary for a good Bible in the Soviet Union on the black market. It's almost impossible.
How much?
Three months' salary.
For one Bible.
Yeah.
My word. And they'll pay it, won't they?
That is
shocking. To get a Bible.
One of my vehicles came back a few weeks ago from Russia with 19 holes drilled right through it. Floor, top, sides. In their search for whatever we had with us at the border. They just take your car to pieces, they ruin it, because they're so desperate, they've got to find out who takes in another message. They're now under glasnost, they're more determined than ever. So let's not be fooled by nice words. The battle is not over, it has only just begun.
Mm. Yeah. Okay, that raises a very interesting question. What form do you see this battle taking now as we move out of the 80s on into the 90s? This spiritual battle, this spiritual battle for the minds and hearts of men and getting the gospel really preached.
The first step is obviously a call to repentance to the so-called Christian nations like your nation, USA, Holland, and where we have had so much liberty, so much knowledge, so many Bibles, so much schools of theology and so on, we must really come back to the Bible, or we too will go back to the jungle. And God has given us His Word. If we take Christianity seriously, you know, we must now first see Christianity as unique. That does not make us superior, but unique in that it is not a religion, it's a way of life. Now, when Christianity becomes a way of life in America, things will change economically, morally. Everything will change in this country when we take Christianity so serious that it becomes a way of life. Then secondly, we must take the Great Commission seriously. Make disciples of all nations. Now, we are so intimidated by iron curtains, sugarcane curtains, Quranic curtains particularly. Yes. What do we really do spiritually for Saudi Arabia? Since I was there, one businessman, a Dutchman, said, he spoke to our ambassador about doing something for the Christians. The ambassador said, don't mention that, don't do that, because we still want to sell them submarines. Now this is what I mean. If we are more interested in selling them F-15s than selling them Jesus Christ, we still lose. And they gain, because they're growing as an ideology. Islam is far more aggressive and effective than anything else. They still grow, and they make converts by the millions. And a convert in Islam is a missionary, is dedicated, is doing something with his word, his holy book, with his message, his way of life, his lifestyle, his five times of prayer every day. They take it so seriously that unless we outdo them in dedication, in a life of prayer, and in reading and obeying our scriptures, we're going to lose. And that's how the percentage is at the moment increasing, but it does not have to keep increasing. It shouldn't. We should be more aggressive as Christians, move in, and disregard all the forbidding borders. Don't take our own lives so seriously that we are not willing to lay it down for Jesus. Jesus always told us this is the way. And John said, hereby know we the love of God, that He laid down His life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives, dear brethren. It's not a suggestion, it is you ought to, 1 John 3:16.
I want to come back to Saudi Arabia in just a moment. And Brother Andrew has just returned, as he said, from there, and I know he has some fascinating things. I know, because I've seen some of them here. I want Jeff to come and bless you in song, and as he sings, I want you to do a couple of things. Number one, those of you that have prayer needs, I want you to phone them in right now. And then I want you to get ready, because Brother Andrew is getting ready now to go back to probably one of the most, if not the most dangerous places in the entire world, Lebanon. And some exciting things are happening over in Lebanon as well, and I want him to share that with us. And then before Brother Andrew leaves, I want us to reach our hands out toward him, that God will bless him and use him even greater and cover him with His protection and with His blood. That as he goes to these troubled parts of the world where many do not want to go. It's if you want to take a vacation, Lebanon isn't a very nice place to go anymore. It was once. But we want to really, really lift Brother Andrew up in prayer. These are strange, unusual days that we live in. And a man who's been right in the middle of spiritual battle is going to give us here in the States, I know, some spiritual insights that will help us to pray better, work more, and get involved in getting this gospel of the kingdom preached in all the world for a witness before Jesus comes. Jeff Benward sings a song that is very appropriate at this moment, the Church of the Living God. Please make your prayer requests and your phone calls right now as he sings.
At His command, waging war for souls held prisoner, condemned by sin to die. Marching on victoriously, facing this battle cry. We are the Church of the Living God. Come along and live forever with the Church of the Living God. Join the song that it rings forever. We are the Church of the Living. Sounds of a gentle wind can be heard in many lands as the army of the living God now become his hands, bringing peace to hearts surrendered whose eternal hope in him rely. They join the march to victory. They sing this battle cry. We are the Church of the Living God. Come along and live forever with the Church of the Living God. Join the song, let it ring forever. Our armor is the Spirit's power. Our standard is the cross. When we are united, we shall never suffer loss. We are the Church of the Living God. Come along and live forever with the Church of the Living God. Join the song, let it ring forever. We are the Church. Living God, we are the Church of the Living God. We are the Church of the Living God.
Jeff Venable, thank you, Jeff. We're having a wonderful first night here at Seattle Tacoma in your beautiful new studio and set that has just been completed, and we've had the joy of dedicating tonight. And what a joy to have one of our wonderful brothers in the Lord, Brother Andrew, with us tonight to share on this first night. Brother Andrew, I on the one hand, let me just put it this way. I hear, not only from you, but from a lot of other people, that evidence of a great move of the Spirit of God is in the earth. Rex Humbard just returned from South America, and he's 40,000 came forward in one altar call to receive Christ. I'm hearing that even over in remote parts of the world, like Australia, there's revival. I'm hearing that Europe is even now being touched and shaken with revival. Now you're telling me even parts of the Middle East, and I want to get into that in a moment, but I guess I'm a little confused. On the one hand, I hear wonderful reports about the Spirit of God moving and revival, and the Spirit of God is falling on all flesh, as Joel prophesied, and yet in another sense, you tell me we're losing the battle. How do we reconcile these two strange...
We're not losing the battle, we're losing some numbers at the moment. But the spiritual battle is not a numbers game.
All right.
You see, I think this is one answer. The church is growing in depth. People are waking up to the fact that there is a suffering church, that there are restrictions, that we must be awake, that we must strengthen what remains, which is at the point of death. Revelation 3, verse 2 was what God told me on my first trip. And more people are now going out, young people, and there is a new wave of missionary activity. We're catching a vision exporting what we really believe, missions like Youth for the Mission and Operation Mobilization and Open Doors and Navigators, Campus Crusade, all those terrific new movements that they're going over the world, and they find that indeed this is an open world and people are waiting. It's amazing, and let's go faster.
Okay, full speed ahead.
Yeah, it's terrific because we're still advancing. Now we are seeing that even the Arab world is opening up, and we witness there are millions of guest laborers, and they are faithful. I want you to pray for them. There are Filipino, Pakistani, other believers among them, and they witness to the Saudis. They win them for Christ. They have miracles, answered prayers.
Okay. All right. Now, I know a little bit about the Arab part of the world because my folks were missionaries to Egypt, and I grew up part of my life there. And I know 35, 40 years ago, when our family was over there, to attempt to convert a Muslim to Christianity was a capital offense. Yeah. I mean, they would kill you, literally. Now, I understand cases that's still the truth. All right, when you went to Saudi Arabia just now, what did you do? How do you get around that law? And how do you preach Christ? And how do you keep your head on your shoulders, I guess, is what I'm...
Well, at the moment, we are not that far yet that we can openly proclaim the gospel to the Saudis. We now work with those who rub shoulders with the Saudis to strengthen them, to encourage them, to provide them with books, because even from foreigners, they take away your Bible. Okay. Even if you only have one Dutch Bible, you can lose that at the airport in Jeddah or Riyadh.
Really?
Yes.
Why?
They're so afraid of this word. This is dynamite. They know it. They know if this book takes the place of the Quran, then there is no chance they can rule anymore as Muslims. They know it. So now we must take in those books, and we do. And so I strengthen them, and we have lots of meetings. Every day, three or four meetings, every day.
Is there a church in Saudi Arabia?
Oh, you better believe it.
How do they meet? How do they worship?
Any big city may have over 50 Christian fellowships, with up to 200 people per fellowship that meet together to worship God.
Are the authorities aware of this?
Yeah, they sometimes raid a group that did in February. And some of those believers are still in prison.
Really?
Yeah, and they were foreigners. I mean, they really clamped down, and yet they so badly need the foreigners, so they also allow a few things that, you know, it's still that 50-50 situation where it can go either side. So now I want us to pray and believe and go in with greater boldness and with more literature, more Bibles, more books, and encourage them so that the breakthrough will occur, because it is already happening. There are Saudi fellowships in the country, big ones.
When you go, do you speak to some of these fellowships and worship with them?
Not with the Saudis. That would be too dangerous for them if I, as a foreigner, would visit them. But I do have meetings with the other Arabs that are in the country and with the expats. And we have tremendous times. And then I give them the scriptures, the Arab Bibles, and I say, this book has been dedicated to give to a Saudi, and you are going to do it. And they accept it as a charge from the Lord.
Now, who are these people you're talking
about? The Arabs. The Arab Christians in the country. From the Palestinians, the Egyptians, the Lebanese, the Syrians. And I know many of them.
So they go in even at their own peril, correct?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
To distribute these Bibles?
Yes.
To preach, to witness in the home fellowships?
Yeah. And I tell them from Scripture and from church history and my own history, this is the only way to do it. Taking the gospel is a thing that takes your life, because you cannot go into the world unless you first come where Paul was, where he said, I have been crucified with Christ. A man who has lost his life to Jesus can never risk it anymore. Isn't that beautiful?
Well,
so all the tension is gone and no risk anymore. You just do it.
Yes.
Now we must learn, because what is the secret of that terrible war, Iraq, Iran? In Islam, that you never have any security of salvation. No assurance, unless you die in the jihad, the holy war.
That's the only way you can be sure you go to heaven, according to
that. The only way. Yeah, no, according to the Quran and the entire Islamic teaching.
Oh,
so Khomeini will never have problems getting millions more of recruits to go to the battlefront. They love it. That's the only way for them to know they go to heaven. And any other Muslim, however devout he is to Islam, he will still have that uncertainty. Will my good deeds
outweigh my bad deeds. That's the whole concept in Islam. You've got to do more good deeds than bad deeds. And since everyone is a sinner by nature, and they are too, they all feel that their bad deeds are more than the good deeds, so they will go to hell when they die. Every Muslim thinks that, except those that go to the front line and lay down their lives in the jihad to kill the infidels and, you know.
See, what a horrendous lie.
It is. It's darkness.
How do you, when you're dealing with a Muslim and speaking to him, when you have that opportunity, how do you present the gospel to him?
First, by showing that I love them. One of our big problems is we have an enemy image. We think the commies are our enemies. We think the Muslims are our enemies. We think the Arabs are our enemies. It's not so. The devil is our enemy.
Amen.
But never people. When you show love, and I have seen it in all my trips in the Middle East, and you give the word of God and you tell them, I love you, here is the word of God, here is the message of Jesus, they always accept it, whether it be Amal or Shiite or Druze or the Syrian troops, they always accept. And I just relive my first 20 years in the communistic countries. They always accept the word of God when you go to them in Siberia or Central Asia or in the inside the Kremlin. I've given out scriptures and they always accept them. Even today, several KGB generals in Moscow carry the pocket Bibles that we gave them this year.
Really?
They love it. Yes, they love it. And I'm sure there are secret believers among them.
I've heard that. And of course, we won't really know, I suppose, till we
get to
heaven.
And there are many secret believers in Saudi Arabia. Actually, we know of thousands that already have been baptized.
What do those devout Muslims think of our Jesus Christ?
Well, according to the Quran, he is one of the 20 main prophets. He's also the healer. So they always want us to pray for healing. Yeah, that's quite open. That does not affect their religion, really. But the main point is, he cannot be the Son of God. Mm. And that is where Christianity is unique. Jesus is the Son of God. If he's not the Son of God, then he has not died for our sins. Then he is not risen from the dead. Then the Bible says we are still in our sins. Then we are the most miserable of all people, because on Sunday we must go to church instead of going to the beach. That would make anybody miserable if you do it for nothing. So I think that's what Paul means in 1 Corinthians 15. So this is the point. And if we cannot prove in our own lives that Jesus is alive and that he is the Son of God, we'll never make any impact on a Muslim. Mm. So our assurance, our joy, our... Well, just what we radiate is going to convince them, not what we preach at them.
Are Muslims stepping across that line and embracing Christ as true Lord
and
Savior?
I saw it in Tehran, in Iran. We had a campaign there not long ago.
Tehran?
Yeah, I saw whole Muslim families, man, wife, heavily veiled, children, walk into the evangelical church. And the pastors told me that at this period of time, 50% of all the people they baptize are converted Muslims. There's a real move of the spirit among the Muslims. Let's go full speed now.
Fast, absolutely.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Yeah, it's happening.
Because that has to be the spirit of God falling upon them, because to see a Muslim step over and become a true believer in Jesus Christ, he can be killed, can't he?
Yeah, and some do.
And some give
and others
lives.
Are in prison, even in Egypt. Where you originally come from, there are believers today in Egypt in prison. A medical doctor is in prison. And it's a very hard life in Egypt to be in prison. I think we should put all our diplomatic efforts and political power to bear on the government of Mubarak to let those Christians free, because they did no crime except they're accused of being a Christian, which in their terminology means despising Islam. You go to prison. Mm. That's the point.
You know,
I think one of the most absolute positive proofs that this is life, it's spirit, it's God, is that those countries are so afraid of it.
Yeah.
You know, we have every Bible. You can go in a bookstore and you can get the Guru and the Nuru and the Luru and the Lulu,
I love
and writings of anybody in the
Baghdad
world,
Gita,
and they're
the,
free to have their writings here.
Yeah.
I'm not afraid of them. I mean, you look at them, and it looks like death, you know. And you go over to the religious section and pick up a Bible in a bookstore, and it just seems like there's life.
Yep.
And we're not afraid of that. Because
of their holy writings.
Their holy writings, and it's almost proof that they know if this word gets inside their borders, it is going to change people, and they're going to turn from their way and not be a communist or
a Muslim. You're saying, then, is the political fears of this book are almost one of the proofs
that, it's real.
That it is the
that
Word
is
of God.
Absolutely.
Spirit.
Yeah, and that makes it so much fun to take that word in, because then you know God is backing you. They cannot stop you. You will succeed, and people will change. You do change the course of history. You're prophetic in everything you do, and you bring about the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that gives the tremendous joy that overcomes all the fear, which you do have naturally.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, getting caught there is not any worse than getting a ticket for speeding on the highway here in California or wherever you are in Washington now. It's the same feeling, you know. You get a little nervous and upset, and then you get over that.
Mm-hmm.
And I've been arrested several times, but you try to see the fun of it. You interrogate them instead of they you. And first time I got arrested was with my wife together, and she didn't like it, incidentally. But after interrogation, the interrogator cut it short after a few hours.
Can you tell us what country you were in?
Yeah, we had just crossed the Iron Curtain in Berlin.
Mm-hmm.
And with scriptures, and they found everything.
East
they
Germany.
Took us to a Russian barrack and searched everything, and then we were interrogated. They found some very discriminating things against me, which I should not have had. And then the interrogator, after some hours, he had tears. He took my hand, he said, "Sir, I promise I'll go back to church again." I was totally convicted.
What did you say to him?
Well, I turned every question around, you know, about the Bible, about my possessions, about my future, about my hope, everything. And then he just, you know...
He was under conviction.
Absolutely. And he had tears. I saw it come, and then he shook my hands. He was shaky, and said, "I promise I'll go back to church." I said, "Then what?" He said, "Take everything back into your car and get out of here."
Mm.
Which we did, that case.
Yes.
Yeah.
You need to teach us a course on personal evangelism, I think, or you taught one great series, I know, on Heroes of the Faith, but, you know, this is something that Americans, I think, are in need of, Brother Andrew.
Yeah, because our heroes of the faith are celebrities. In the Bible, the heroes of the faith are martyrs. That's what we have to learn, to pay the price, and then we can go anywhere. Because there's no closed door in the world, but we've got to have that Holy Spirit boldness, and I don't have that by nature. I'm a very shy person. But when I get arrested, I get very aggressive, and I know I have a message, and even if they take away my Bible, I still have a message. It's inside. As a matter of fact, when I entered Saudi last month, the Dutch diplomatic leader there, I won't say anymore, he said, "Andrew, the thing that you smuggle into this country, they will never confiscate it at the border because it's inside you."
Mm-hmm.
I said, "Yeah, you understand it.
Mm-hmm.
It's inside us. The kingdom of God is inside us. Who can take it away?"
Nobody.
So you're really telling me now that even in Muslim countries, there is hard evidence that the Spirit of God is being outpoured, that Muslims are coming to Christ.
Yeah.
In other words, something different and unusual is happening.
Yeah.
Correct?
Yeah.
Did you say you had a baptismal service in Saudi Arabia?
I did not have. I they told me about that. Even in the most secret places, the highest places in the capital city, sometimes in the Red Sea, they baptize up to 100 persons in one service.
Mm-hmm.
But they're all expats, but God is moving there. And they are in touch with the Saudis. So we must keep in touch with them, and then they pass it on. If we don't strengthen them, they lose courage, because it is very hard life. And I mean, these Filipinos, they work hard in extreme heat for $300 a month, and sometimes they do not go home for 2 or 3 years to see their family with little children. It's a terrible life. It's slavery, literally slavery. But they're so afraid. You know that after the last Hajj 2 months ago, the pilgrimage to Mecca, 20,000 Iranians did not return home. They're now underground.
20,000
did not return home with their weapons and explosives, and they're very, very scared that something will happen in that country. And I think we ought to pray that at least
there will be enough stability to get the gospel in. We don't need war situations. A little bit pressure and persecution will do us good, but not a devastating mass extermination of people. That's a terrible thing. Oh, God must hate that.
You're on your way to Lebanon again?
Yes.
When?
In a few weeks' time.
A few weeks?
Yeah.
And what will you be doing in Lebanon this time?
I will continue the work that we talked about last time, getting the scriptures into the big refugee camps. There's still 30,000 badly suffering Palestinians in the Shatia and the Bourse Barajne camps in West Beirut. And I have very good contacts, and I have a lot of scriptures already there, and the team ready. And we want to do far more for those people that are suffering so much as political pawns, written off like most of the Palestinians are, or labeled as terrorists like the PLO is. But I want to see them as people. They're hungry.
Yes.
And I love them. I love everyone there. And I want to burn out for Jesus in that area. I want to.
Politically, there is no answer, is there? In that?
Because it's a theological conflict. It's a false prophet against the prophet of God. Mm-hmm. It's a spiritual conflict, and unless we see it as such and treat it as such, we'll always be in a mess. There's no military solution, there's no political solution, because it's a spiritual conflict. Mm-hmm. It's a counterfeit religion that you face, and an unbelieving Israeli nation. So the only power of God that can really come to the area is from the outside, when we, you and I, go in with our prayer, with our support, with our love, with the word of God, and just share. Sit with them where they sit. Weep where they weep. And then preach the word. Share Jesus. It can be done. We're doing it.
It's a big job.
It is a big job.
You were telling me some fascinating stories, and before we pray, and Brother Andrew, before we sing another song, I know there are a lot of Muslim, we get letters from Muslim people.
Good.
Many Arabs and Muslims in the United States who happen to come across this strange phenomenon they call Christian television. I mean, it's so foreign to them, and we get wonderful letters.
I hope that then tonight they understand we love them. We don't despise them. We don't look down on them.
Of course
not. We love them.
Yes. In a moment, I want you to speak to them and tell them how they can find the true prophet of God, as we say. But where do all of these items come from now?
I'll show you this one. I took this one from the international airport in Tehran. Remember God. You know, the Muslim is so God conscious.
This was on the wall of the...
Oh yeah, in the international airport.
Okay.
You know, everything that you do and see there is telling you about God. And that's very interesting.
Now who would they say this God is?
Well, Allah.
Allah.
Sure.
And do they consider Allah to be the same God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob?
Yeah, yeah. Not Isaac, Ishmael. That was the first one. Ishmael was the one that Abraham sacrificed on the altar.
According
not Isaac.
To them.
Yeah, according to the Quran.
I see. They rewrote the scripture a little bit there.
The consciousness of God is expressed in, for instance, this monument in Jeddah. Whatever way you look at that huge monument, those pillars, it reads Allah. From any direction, it reads Allah. Allah.
I see.
They're so conscious of God, and they want people to be that way. I have the Arab news with me from a couple of weeks ago, and that has, of course, the prayer times for the cities in Arabia, but also how many people have now embraced Islam out of the Asian, European, and African nationalities. This is the main items in that country.
What
conquest?
What do you ascribe this tremendous revival, as it were, amongst Mohammedans?
Revival is the right word. They have come to a new consciousness that they are a people of destiny, that time is on their side, that God, quote unquote, is on their side. That's why he gave them the oil and the world's money and the whole Islamic revolution. And they're just picking up where they left off 400 years ago when they were defeated in Europe by the Reformation forces. Mm-hmm. And today they're very strong because it's a triumphalist religion. they do not just claim the Arab population, they will not stop until they have the whole world. Mm. And it's a worldwide conflict, you
really?
See.
Yeah. They are that zealous. They want
Absolutely.
To make converts then of we Christians.
Oh, the minute Absolutely. They become a Muslim, they're immediately a minister, aren't they? I mean, they have to go out and make converts immediately.
They do automatically. That's why they copy us. If you go to hotels in Asia, you don't see the Gideon Bible in your hotel room. You see a Quran in the hotel room. Mm. And when you go to the souvenir shops, now you buy pocket Qurans with mother of pearl covers. and the dome here instead of a church or a cross. It's an exact copy of the Bibles that you buy in Jerusalem or in some of the Christian bookstores in this country. They're zealous. They're just advocating. If in Saudi Arabia you buy a calculator, it's not called a calculator. It's called a prayer calculator. Because the first button you press tells you what time you have to pray.
Really?
Yeah. So everything is in the service of religion, and that's why you hear the call to prayer from the mosques, and not only the call to prayer, but part of the prayer, part of the teaching. When you get on the airplane, just before takeoff, you hear an announcement in beautiful English. The next announcement is made in the Arab language, and it is the prayer of the Prophet for the travelers. You have to sit under the loud prayer from the Quran for the travelers. And I was there, and I got my elbow in the ribs of my neighbor. I didn't know him. I said, "It's time we pray to Jesus, man." He said, "Yes, sir." And I prayed very loud to Jesus. I prayed for the plane and the crew and the passengers and for the country we were going to fly over. And I was still praying aloud when the Quran had already stopped. And then I said, "Amen." And then my neighbor began to pray. He was a Christian, born-again Christian. I didn't know him. And it was great because you've got to be aggressive and don't just let things come over you. Not any evil. Mm. Not in this country nor there.
We can't even pray in our schools here in America.
Because you've let them take it from you. You were not aggressive to defend what God had given you. That's what I tell this nation. And if we lose by default, then only one is to blame. That's the church, not the enemy.
Your message is a disturbing message, Brother Andrew, but it's one we need. I know you're trying basically to tell us to wake up, aren't you?
We must wake up, and we must pray. We must believe. We must go. We must live Christian lives. We must not be a contradiction to our testimony. We must be real, and then we can win the world. Yes. Yeah, absolutely.
Mm. Would you take a minute? I know there are many Muslims watching now, and share Christ with them before we pray.
Yeah, I want to share that because God is a God of love. Now, in the Quran, God is also a God of love, and He also forgives sin. But God only loves those that do good, whose good deeds outweigh the bad deeds, who fulfill their five daily duties, and then the biggest one, going to the Hajj at least once a year when they can afford it. But the wonderful thing about Christianity that makes Christianity unique is God loves us unconditionally.
Amen.
God does not demand that we first become good or change our own lives and cleanse our own hearts. God takes us as we are because that's why He gave His Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. He did die. And of course the Quran too says that He died on the cross. But we know that He died to forgive sins, that He rose again from the dead. And that He now says, and this makes Him unique, "I am the way, I am the truth, I am life, the only life." And you don't have to reason it out with your head, it's a matter of surrendering your heart. And how beautiful, because the very word Islam means submission. But when you submit to the person of Jesus Christ, you experience a change in your heart. That nobody can explain with his mind or brain or intellect. It's there. And you know that you are a new person, born from the Spirit of God, and then everything comes in place, and you know, now I can follow Jesus Christ. Then you take the step of baptism, follow Him, make a radical break with old religions, including your own, and the old ways of life, hypocrisy, the sin, the darkness, covering up of your bad deeds. And then you walk in the light and you are a Christian follower of Jesus Christ, a believer. It's the only way. Do it.
Mm-hmm. Would you just lead us in a prayer, Brother Andrew, and invite them to know this Jesus?
Yes, do pray this prayer with me. Lord Jesus Christ, I have heard about you tonight. I see your beauty. I see how you can change people. You can make from a weak person a strong person, from a sick person a healthy person, from a sinner a saint. You can change society. You can change my nation. But Lord, I ask you, change me. I confess that I am a sinner. My bad deeds far outweigh my good deeds.
Yes,
there's no way I can make up for that in my own strength. But I come to you because your love is unconditional. You require only that I kneel before you and say, Lord Jesus, come into my heart. So Lord, I pray that many who are watching us tonight will pray that prayer in all simplicity, not because we understand, but because we submit to you and we say, Lord Jesus, take over my life. And I pray, Lord, for this great nation of United States of America,
yes,
with so much wealth, prosperity, knowledge, morals, principles, tradition, and background. God, revive us again,
amen,
Lord,
Jesus,
so that this nation will again be able to say to the whole world, give me your poor, give me your persecuted, give me your oppressed, that this will become a haven for those that have to run from totalitarian regimes, from repressive regimes, from war and revolution, that they will come to the shores of America and find Jesus Christ as the source of this nation's righteousness. God, make it true again in this country. Make it true in my country, Lord. I'm brokenhearted over Western Europe.
Jesus.
That Lord God in righteousness will go out to conquer the world for Jesus Christ into the communistic countries, into the Islamic countries, into the heathen countries, into every dark place of the world to bring men and women and boys and girls to a new life in Jesus Christ and the nations to righteousness. God, help us to believe the Bible, act upon it, and really follow Jesus and keep our heads high, that we are not ashamed of anybody as we continue to preach that Jesus Christ is Lord. Hallelujah. Amen.
Thank
amen.
You.
Amen. Amen. Brother Andrew, what can we do to help you? You're going to Beirut. You're going back to the Middle East.
What do you want to do?
I want to help you get the Word of God into those camps. I want to help you spread the gospel. I want to see revival come to the Arab people.
I need a lot of prayer. I need a lot of money because I talk about millions of people that I want to reach, and I am going to reach them.
Yes, yes. When, you don't tell us exactly when you go, and I know there's a reason for that.
Yeah.
But in the near future.
Yeah, in coming weeks.
You'll be going to Beirut.
West Beirut.
West Beirut.
Yes, to the
the most dangerous part.
Well, the only danger is when you're out of the will of God, so.
So what is needed? Do you need more Bibles?
I need a lot more Bibles. Yes.
We helped earlier
yes,
get a vehicle to help transport.
Tremendous. Because of the help you gave me previously, we took in 10,000 New Testaments to Iraq.
Mm.
And 1,000 complete Bibles.
Beautiful.
They're now in the country, in the hands of the people in Iraq.
Really? It's,
and that hasn't happened for years. They have totally closed that country.
I think we ought to just praise the Lord for that, don't you? They are there tonight.
Yep.
Yeah. Well, it's daytime over there right now.
Yeah, they're there.
Yeah.
And Bibles are still going into Iran every week. We take them in every week.
Every week.
Yes. And Bibles are getting into Saudi Arabia, and we're training young people in Egypt to evangelize the Muslims. We help train Christian Arabs in Israel to reach out to the Muslims in Israel. And I tell you, friends, if you want to be nice to Israel, you better love the Arabs. Then you solve the problem.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's a spiritual problem. Make them brothers and sisters in Christ, then you solve the problem. So we need a lot of help and support. We still need more vehicles in those countries for our co-workers because they're getting all over the place now. Our movement is growing in the Middle East. It really is. It's very encouraging. We're full speed forward now.
Glory.
We really are.
Let's just leave it right there.
Amen. Yes.
All right. All right. Let me say this. We still have the account set up.
So any of you that want to help Brother Andrew, I promise you that we'll forward every dollar
great
that you send to help buy these Bibles, more vehicles, yep, whatever he needs. You know, I have tried so hard, Brother Andrew, for 10 years nearly, to persuade the Egyptian government or the Israeli government or the Jordan government. I've tried every way I know to get a television station built over in the Middle East somewhere. I know where it should go. It should go right on the border between Egypt and Israel.
Yeah.
I know the spot. I know the mountain. I know where it should go.
Well, let's all pray. Let's believe God that it will happen.
I want us to pray.
Yeah.
But until that day, I know someday I shall have that station over there dedicated to peace. We will make time available to Christians, Muslims, and Jews. Mm-hmm. Equal time. We will go to the mountain, and they may call on their gods, and we will call on our gods. Okay? But until that day comes...
We want to see who's the strongest, then, like Elijah on the Carmel,
amen,
right?
Amen.
Oh, don't kill your enemies, though. Let's bring life.
But I don't fear a contest.
No, there is not. Not since Calvary. You
amen
see, we have a new starting point.
But until that day comes, what you're doing, and the getting the Word of God in, and going and touching those people, loving them, putting the Word of God in their hand, is the best way that I know of until we can have the mass communication medias.
Yeah.
So we're going to pray for you tonight.
Great.
And I want those of you that have caught the spirit of this man, one of God's great pioneers, one of God's servants, as needful in this generation as the Apostle Paul was in his generation, to go to the out-of-the-way forbidden places and preach the gospel. I want you to not only pray for Brother Andrew, but I know God's speaking to many of your hearts out there to do something more than just prayer, but to make a special gift of love, which I promise to send completely to him for the purpose of preaching the gospel to the Middle East and other parts of the world. Many urgent requests are coming in, and we're going to pray. Franklin Graham is here. He's going to join us in just a moment. But share, honey, just a few of the prayer needs, and then we're going to not only pray for your needs and in this room, but I want you in this room and you across America to reach your hands out to this, our brother, Brother Andrew. And we're going to pray that God will literally open the windows of heaven upon him and pour an anointing and a blessing upon him that he has never experienced before, and use him in a mightier way than ever before. Will you join with me in that in just a moment? Share, honey, just a few of the needs.
Honey, here's someone just needs healing in their body, deliverance from drugs, very severely depressed tonight, healing emphysema. Here's a sweet little girl called in, 7 years old, said, "My mom and dad have separated, and I'm so distraught and confused." And the little partner said she was just overwhelmed, this little child, and called in for help. Just so many physical healing and rebellion in a body. Here's someone that has AIDS, has a serious drug habit, and they've called in for prayer.
In the first hour of the first Network Praise the Lord program from Seattle, Tacoma, Estella from Seattle, 26 years of age, just gave her heart to Jesus.
Elsa.
And Elsa, 49 years of age, from Auburn. And Cindy, age 27, from Pacific, Washington. That's good. We hadn't even had the altar call yet. People are getting saved. That's wonderful. That's wonderful. This was a special message to you, Brother Andrew. A Palestinian Christian has called in and asked for us to pray for him and uphold him in his work and his trip to the Netherlands.
Oh.
So
beautiful.
God sending Arab missionaries apparently even to your country.
Good.
Let's pray. Let's agree right now. Stretch your hands out toward Brother Andrew. You at home do the same. And in this audience tonight, let's believe God not only for these needs, But for Brother Andrew, as he goes again across the seas to the Middle East, particularly to Lebanon. Heavenly Father, first of all, we praise you and we thank you for the promise that you gave us that you would build your church and the very gates of hell should not prevail against it. And Lord, we pray now that as Brother Andrew goes again to these troubled spots of the world, that your Holy Spirit will go with him, even before him, Lord, preparing the way, touching the hearts and lives of these who are in such darkness and such blackness spiritually. Oh God, unless we take the message to them, they will never hear. Unless they see you in us, in your people, they will never know. Unless they can read your word, they will never have the light of your gospel. Oh God, we pray that you'll cover him with your love and with your precious blood and presence. Keep him, Lord, in the very center of your will. Open the doors that should be opened. Close those doors that should be closed. Keep him. Anoint him in a mightier way than ever before, that we can see this gospel of the kingdom preached in all the world for a witness before you come. Lord, that is also your promise, and we stand on it today. Lord, for all these other needs now, we lift them to you, urgent needs. We are a needy people. Touch, heal, bless, save, fill. But Lord, more than anything else, may your Holy Spirit awaken your church in America, in Europe, in other parts of the world that has been slumbering and sleeping. Lord, let us hear that midnight cry go forth that the bridegroom is about to come. Oh God, let us not be slumbering. May we be awake with our lamps trimmed and burning, well, ready to welcome the bridegroom when he comes. Lord, we just thank you tonight for what our ears have heard. And may we never be the same because of it, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Praise God. Jeff Benward sings another mighty song of praise, simply the Redeemer. Let's tell him welcome to Tacoma, Seattle.
There's a hand that's been reaching out with love since time began. There's a voice that's been calling to the heart of every man. To hold this hand is to touch forever. Voice is to know that never will a sunrise seem hopeless anymore. Redeemer, Redeemer, arms that long to hold us when shame tells the heart we're all alone. The Master's calling, leave yesterday behind. At the end of yourself you find the Redeemer. When your heart is lost, the will to dream, from the guilt of failure past, when your voice is lost, the strength to cry, when only sorrow seems to last. this hand, touch forever, hear his voice, and know that never will the sun rise, seem hopeless. Shame tells the heart we're all alone. The master's calling, leave yesterday behind. At the end of yourself you find the Redeemer. Redeemer, Redeemer. When shame tells the heart we're all alone, the master's calling, leave yesterday behind. At the end of yourself you find redeemed.
Jeff Benwood. This has been an exciting first night here in Seattle, Tacoma, on the beautiful new set of your new studio here for Channel 20. We're having a wonderful time tonight and all this week. We'll be coming to you live from this new studio here. So we hope those of you in this area will come in night after night. A lot of questions are coming in, and I wish we had time. Real quickly, maybe just before I introduce our special guest, what's happening in the Ukraine, someone said. Are they getting any Ukrainian Bibles, Brother Andrew?
Yes.
The answer is yes. Someone was also, an electrifying report came to us from a dear friend from London not long ago, who literally went in and prayed with Muammar Gaddafi of Libya. And
he'll be able to give it later.
The story is still unfolding, and again, some of these are sensitive areas that you can't say too much about because it could jeopardize the operation.
Right.
When Brother Andrew was bringing a million Bibles into China,
didn't talk about that.
you remember back in World War II, the old slogans that would be put around in the supermarkets, the slip of a lip could sink a ship.
Yep.
Was
still true.
One of them, and that still is true today, isn't it? I want you to meet Franklin Graham, if you haven't already. He's been our guest a number of times on Praise the Lord. Always a joy to have him with us. You probably have heard of his father, who is a fairly well-known evangelist in the world today, Dr. Billy Graham. But Franklin is moving out in his own right and doing some very, very exciting things. He is president of Samaritan's Purse, which is a Christian mission organization committed to meeting emergency needs among missionaries around the world. He's a member of the board of directors of the organization, many organizations, such as the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association, Blue Ridge Broadcasting, and Mafraq.
Mafraq Sanatorium. It's a hospital in northern Jordan, about 30 miles from the Syrian border.
Really?
Yes, sir.
There's a little story there, I'll bet. Mm-hmm. He's also president of World Medical Mission. Franklin is the author of the biography of Bob Pierce, This One Thing I Do, from Boone, North Carolina. Let's tell Franklin Graham. Welcome. How you doing, brother? Good to see you. We got to move these chairs. I'm too far away from him for tomorrow night. Anyway, how are you doing? Where you been? What you been up to?
Doing very well. Have spent most of this past year in Africa and also in the Middle East, as Brother Andrew was sharing, where he has been. Sometimes our paths cross, and it's interesting that our paths cross tonight. We have met before, and I believe in Central America we've bumped into each other, and then yeah. Africa, and now on your set, so it's a great privilege for me.
You've had some experiences over in Lebanon where Brother Andrew's headed.
Yes.
In case he hasn't heard, and of course a lot of our viewers haven't, tell us about that one hair-raising experience you had over when the Israeli army was invading up into Lebanon, and what? Bombs and shrapnel and...
Oh, I was in Lebanon during the invasion of southern Lebanon by the Israeli army. And on several occasions we were caught in sniper attacks where the bullets were actually hitting the pavement right in front of the car as we would drive. As you saw on the television, the Israelis bombing West Beirut. Well, what you didn't see was the PLO bombing of East Beirut. And I got caught in several of their artillery attacks, and the particular church I was in was shelled, and we hid under the steps as the concrete and rubble came crashing down around. But
did you really think this was it at the time, or did you have...
Well, you know, you be honest with you, you do kind of wonder sometimes. And it's not necessarily you aren't afraid, but you're just wondering, well, Lord, if this is the hour for me to come home, then so be it.
Yes. Yes.
But to be honest with you, the most afraid that I have ever been is in Angola, where I traveled throughout the interior. And once you leave the major cities, the Cubans and the Soviets and the Marxist government control the cities. But once you get out of the cities, you get into the bush, and UNITA, the guerrillas, mm-hmm. control the bush. And, of course, UNITA is supported by the United States and other Western countries. But when they see a car coming down the road, they don't know who it is, and they just shoot at it. And I was riding with this one missionary, and he said, you know, Franklin, it's getting dark, and I don't like to be on the road at dark because they see the car lights. During the day, they can recognize my car, and they don't shoot. But at night, they see the car lights, and they just shoot at the car lights. Mm. He says, you know, I don't like being on the road after dark. And I thought, well, if he's nervous, believe me, I'm going to be nervous. But that was the only place, to be honest with you, I really, God was calling me to go, and I resisted. And I resisted for several months, and then I went, and I was very much afraid, but I knew that God had called me there.
What was your mission to Angola?
We were there to look at some mission hospitals that's run by African Evangelical Fellowship, a place called Kalikimbi. And it's interesting that here is a Marxist government, but missionaries are still allowed. The door is not shut. You've got a number, you have some Southern Baptists there, you have brethren that are working in that country. Fantastic that here, Americans, here we're supporting UNITA, the guerrillas, but yet this Marxist government allows Americans of all things, American missionaries, to come into the country.
How do you reconcile that? What's
They need the medicine. They need the doctors.
I see.
Cuba has sent some 300 doctors to that country, but it's more or less a joke. They're not even good paramedics, much less doctors. And they really rely on these missionary doctors to do a lot that the government themselves cannot.
So there's no change of heart in the communists and now opening up and allowing more freedom for the preaching of the gospel. It's just they need you.
They need you, but the mission doesn't go unless they have the opportunity to preach. If they can't preach, they don't go. Mm-hmm. And that's what I like about African Evangelical Fellowship. A man by the name of Bob Foster is the director. He is he's a Canadian, I'm sorry. But a fantastic man, and a man who's not afraid of anybody, anything, and will go any place to preach the gospel. And he has a number of his team in Angola, same thing in Mozambique, a country that just a few years ago was pretty much closed to the gospel, is opening up in a tremendous way.
Are you seeing what Brother Andrew's talking
Absolutely.
About?
Absolutely.
The world, in some cases, is opening to the gospel.
Absolutely.
That has been closed, huh?
That's correct.
I'm glad I did not meet you in Angola, because at that time I was probably with the UNITA. I was preaching to the rebels.
You could have been shooting at him.
Oh, I would hate to do that.
What evidence do you have now? What makes you know that the gospel is now opening?
Well, when we go into a country, the work that we're involved in, Samaritan's Purse and our medical arm, World Medical Missions, we generally go into work through the church in that particular country, the national church. to find out what needs they have and work through them. Many times in these countries, like in Angola or Mozambique, they're suffering. They need tools, but yet they also need some basics. They need many times food. In Angola, the believers themselves are hungry. It's one of the most desperate places I've ever seen.
True.
Same thing in Mozambique. And I believe that when people are suffering, we should respond. But yet when we see our own brothers and sisters in the faith, our responsibility is to them first. And so we don't go in and just do a general feeding program, but we go in and work through the church, give them the food, give them the tools, and assist them. And when you work with them, they tell you what's going on. They'll tell you, yes, we've got so many of our brothers in prison, but yet we have seen these many baptisms, and we have seen these churches open, even though these have closed, these have opened. Right now in Ethiopia, in the southern part of the country, in Ethiopia, one particular denomination has had around 1,800 of their churches closed. However, in the south, recently, 200 churches were given permission to reopen. And so we are seeing some tremendous movement. And the Marxist governments, on many occasions, have looked at the church and have thought that the church was their enemy, are now taking a second look. Mm-hmm. And they don't see them as maybe the danger they once thought they were. And there are cracks that are beginning to open up in some places.
What other evidences do you see as you move around the world? What are you convinced, as many are, that we are really moving into that last great outpouring of the Holy Spirit that Joel prophesied, that in the latter days upon all flesh?
I believe that we are in approaching the latter days. How close or how far, I don't know. The Lord knows those things. But I am seeing in every country that I have visited, I'm sure Brother Andrew would agree, we find God's people doing God's work.
Yeah.
Even though circumstances may look impossible, God is at work. And I want to do all that I can. I'm sure, like yourself and Brother Andrew, we want to do all that we can to assist in the spreading of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And this is our purpose, and this is my interest. However, our little thing is to take the hurts of this world, to take the wars, to take the famines, and use them as stepping stones from which to preach and to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Good.
And whatever stepping stone we can stand on, we'll do that.
Do we have a roll-in?
Yes, I've got a tape of a drip irrigation project that we're doing in Ethiopia. Mm-hmm. And we're doing it in Kenya, we'll be doing it in Angola, and we're starting now in Mozambique. And it's just a simple little irrigation project that was developed by a Dutch farmer, a man by the name of Art Van Wingerton, who lives outside of Asheville, North Carolina. And he's one of the largest greenhouse operators in the United States. Got 16 children, all by the same wife, and they're all in the greenhouse business.
Really? The typical Dutch. is that little roll-in up and ready to go? It's ready. Okay, if we can roll the monitor over here so we can see it. I like the way you put that, Franklin. All of these projects are simply stepping stones.
Absolutely, right. Just stepping stones.
So that we can proclaim the gospel
of
Jesus Christ. Just before we roll it, are there any little breakthroughs that you could share, say this year of 87? Anything that really stands out in your mind?
Right now, I've spent, again, a lot of time in Ethiopia. And I've just seen the doors open in Ethiopia like I never thought I'd ever see them, because I've been working there for some time. And it's a difficult country. But just with this agricultural project, these drip irrigation units that we've got 3,000 now in Ethiopia, we're seeing the church. The church is now distributing these units. They're the ones seen by the government as bringing in a new technology to their people, that's helping their people. As a result, it's got the interest of the government. And the government's watching. They're looking. The government is coming to the church saying, how can we get some of these units? We want to demonstrate these on our own state farms. But yet it gives the church an opportunity to say, yes, we'll do it. We'd be glad to help you. And it gives them an opportunity to witness and to preach to their own people.
All right, let's have a look. We're going to Ethiopia right now?
I think so. I haven't seen it myself, so it better be.
All right. You'll tell us what we're seeing here, I'm sure.
Good. Stop tape. Jan, Paul, I'm right now in Africa, where we're hoping to introduce a new drip irrigation system to African farmers. This is a very simple system developed by a Christian Dutch farmer who had a concern for African farmers. He actually started down in Haiti. It was proven to be very successful. And we believe in areas of Africa and other areas of the world where water is very scarce, that this can help solve some of the problems. It's not a cure, but yet it will assist our farmers to increase their yield, increase their production, but more importantly, is to be done through the church where the gospel of Jesus Christ can go forward and to be proclaimed.
The church had an open door to share the church faith in various localities, in the Muslim communities and in other communities. The church believes in helping the whole person, the spiritual part as well as the physical part of the person. So this has given the church a real opportunity, and even the government is very interested in the activities of the church, and the government is fully supporting the church in this area.
So whenever you can increase your yield and decrease your water, we thought you should know it too.
The system is a very simple system, which uses just a small bucket, it could be a large bucket, with two drip lines approximately 30 feet long. And this system can grow four rows of vegetables, but here in Africa, this system will feed approximately one family with fresh vegetables, which is very, very important, especially in areas where there has been famine and starvation. We're talking about $10 per drip unit. To ship it over here, however, it almost doubles the cost, somewhere around $20. We have already sent 3,000 units with fertilizer. An organization, a seed company in California, donated close to $500,000 worth of seed, which are here with us. And so we're just grateful to all the people that have banded together and worked to make this possible. Many people have spent a lot of time, but our purpose and our object of this whole project is to glorify the person of Jesus Christ. And I believe when people are hungry, when people are dying, when people are starving, to come and tell them about God's love is good. But when you can come in and you can show love and you can give them something, a tool which will better their life, and then you tell them about God's love, they're going to listen to you because you put your faith in action. And so we believe in taking relief and taking drought areas like this and using it in such a way is to turn it into belief. So there are areas of the world that have suffered tremendously. Same thing in northern Kenya, where it hasn't rained for months. And if we can introduce a drip irrigation system that can save their water, it will be a great tool. And many of the Trinity partners have contributed in the past, and we just want to thank you for your prayers and for your help and for your support. And may God continue to bless you and use your valuable ministry. I'm Franklin Graham, reporting from Africa.
Hey, thank you for that wonderful report. Boy, missions technology has changed, I guess, since the kind of poetic days when we think of a David Livingstone, you know, walking through the jungle with a pith helmet on, short pants, and a Bible under it. This is a whole new technique, isn't it, to
Peace Corps Christianity.
The Peace Corps, Dan said. Of
super.
But again, everything that we're wanting to do is to strengthen the believers in these countries so they can earn a right to proclaim the gospel. You know, I could go to a country like Ethiopia, and it would take years for me to learn their language if I could. I doubt if I could. But yet then it would take even longer to learn the culture to where I could be effective to really witness and to proclaim the gospel in their culture. But, you know, they're ones that are there. They're Ethiopian believers, and all they need is just some tools. They just need a little help. Yeah. They'll do it, and we just need to strengthen them. And we have so much in this country, even though the stock market today had some problems. But yet, you know, the gospel is going to go forward.
Amen.
And it doesn't depend on the stock market or whatever. But we have many resources in this country, And if we can just use just a little bit to help our own brothers and sisters, that's what I want to do in these difficult areas of the world. But God has opened up many doors, and I'm just grateful to Him, you know, that He'd even want to use me. I really don't count myself worthy to even be a part of some of these projects that we've been involved in. But for some reason, He's allowed us, and we're grateful to Him.
The answer to that is in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, Graham, God hath chosen us foolish things to confound the wise, yes.
so that He gets
no flesh
glory.
Should glory mm-hmm. in His presence. Mm-hmm. For folks that would like to get in touch with you and learn more about what you're doing and how to help you do it, they can just write to you at Boone, North Carolina?
Box 3000, Boone, North Carolina.
That's easy. Franklin Graham, Box 3000, Boone, North Carolina. Zip code?
28607.
There, it's on the screen right now, so grab a pencil and jot it down. Mm-hmm. Any of you will want to get in touch with Franklin, correspond with him, help him. Maybe, do you ever need volunteers to go? Do you need people that will really commit their lives? And
yes, sir. Sometimes when it comes to a technical thing. Right now, we're in the process of buying a well drilling truck for Ethiopia to give to the church, mm-hmm. and we're needing someone who's an expert in well drilling, who would be willing to go maybe for a year to instruct the Ethiopians on how to do it themselves, and then turn it all over to them.
Good. All right, Jeff Benward's going to take us out in song. Boy, time flies when you're having a good time, doesn't it? Have we reached our port yet, dear?
Yes, we're heading for the shore. Few more fish.
Nearing the shore. All right.
You know, we want to say that this whole week, the third hour of praise is going to be a very special series by Hal Lindsey on the Book of Romans. So you'll want to watch the third hour of praise this entire week and enjoy our Hal teaching on the Book of Romans.
Good. Let's sing that final song with Jeff.
Because He Lives.
Because He Lives. We can go to Beirut. Or
yes.
Ethiopia, or wherever
yes.
the Lord would call
or
us to
Puget go. Or the Puget Sound.
Or the Puget Sound. Let's tell Brother Andrew, Franklin
yes.
Graham,
all of you.
Jeff Benward, all of our wonderful guests. We'll be back again with you again live tomorrow night from the TVN Love Boat.
God sent His only begotten Son. The angel said, call His name Jesus. He came here just to love, to heal and forgive. Jesus gave His life to buy our pardon. An empty grave is there to prove that Jesus, He lives. Because
we're so glad you've been with us for Praise the Lord. If you'd like an audio cassette of Praise the Lord, please write and ask for program 1019-87. That's 1019-87. The tapes will be sent for your love gift to the Praise the Lord program. TVN has a worldwide ministry. We need your love gifts, large or small, to help keep the gospel of Jesus Christ going around the world. So write today, Praise the Lord, P.O. Box A, Santa Ana, California, 92711. Or in Canada, write TVN, P.O. Box 23517, Vancouver, AMF, Vancouver, British Columbia, V7B, 1W2. If you would like to contact guests or musicians for their tapes, books, or albums, please write us at TVN and we'll forward your correspondence. If you haven't asked Christ into your life, call our prayer partner now and pray to receive Jesus as Savior and Lord. Now, until next time, remember to praise the Lord.
This program was brought to you by the prayers and contributions of our faithful partners throughout the United States of America.